Previously on Skip and Josh Sports Show.
Funny that we're getting so riled up about this. I don't like golf. You don't like golf. I don't play golf. You don't play golf. I don't watch it. You don't watch it. You don't care. But it makes me nuts that he's all over the TV.
Speaking of golf, last thing.
Speaking of golf, golf.
You're listening to the Skip and Josh Sports Show.
Skip.
Hey, Cub.
How's it going?
Great, great.
So, you know, we talked about having guests on the show and different correspondents from different cities. And so far, we've had our Chicago correspondent and we've had our Atlanta correspondent. I'm excited to tell the listeners that we now have our Philadelphia correspondent on the line, and I'll let you introduce him.
So our Philly correspondent is none other than Mark. Hey, Mark, how's it going?
Good, and yourself?
Great.
I'm thrilled to be here.
And we're so happy to have you. And like all of our other guests so far, Mark is actually originally from Montreal, although you've been away from Montreal for so long, right? I don't know what year you moved away from Montreal, but it was in the 90s, right?
Yeah, it was in 1993.
Yeah, there you go. And when did you actually move to Philadelphia? I know, like, I don't want to go through your whole history of where you've lived, but I don't think the listeners care about that. But when did you settle in Philadelphia? Was it 2001? 2000?
Yep. 2001. 2001.
That's what I thought. I had my timeline. Like, I knew it was around there. Like most Canadians, I mean, I guess you still consider yourself a Canadian. Hockey, I think, has taken over as your biggest passion. I know that you're a season ticket holder for the Flyers.
I am.
Yeah. And I'm always amazed whenever we see each other, like, how big of a Flyers fan you are. Like, last year when we saw you in Christmas time, the Flyers looked like dead in the water. And you were like, no. They're still going to make the playoffs. I still have hope. Yeah, and, like, they made it. It was crazy. I was like, I couldn't believe it. So, like, tell us how the Flyer, like, fandom started with you.
You know what? I have no idea.
Oh, my God.
It actually started from out of nowhere, right? So I, for a long time, I followed hockey, but I didn't go to games. I wouldn't necessarily watch them on TV, but I would definitely read about it in the newspaper, watch highlights, but nothing special. And then all of a sudden, a couple of years ago, I said, you know, this team actually has a little bit of oomph to it. There's a lot of young kids who are coming up. We're going to look forward to seeing them over the next few years. Now is the time. Now's the time to get started and hope and just watch them blossom. And that's what started happening last year, for example, with Shane Gostisbehere.
I know. You love Gostisbehere. It's insane.
I have a question for Mark, actually.
Sure.
So I realize you live in Philadelphia, and when you live in a city for a long time, for as long as you've lived there, you obviously become a fan of the home teams. And I can understand in baseball because your former city, Montreal, doesn't have a baseball team, and football, your former city doesn't have an NFL team, and your former city doesn't have a basketball team. But your former city, Montreal, has arguably the most storied hockey franchise of all time. And so I'm curious to know, you go to all these Flyers games, when it's Flyers versus Canadians, do you have, like, is it tough for you?
You're going down the wrong path.
Like, who do you root for?
Mark was never a Habs fan. Mark's one of those Montrealers who actually hated the Habs.
Wait, hold on. Hate is a strong word. I love them when we're talking Larry Robinson, Ken Dryden, right?
Right.
LeFleur, Steve Shutt, right? That era, love the Habs. When you start moving into the late 80s, that's when the Hartford Whalers ruled.
Okay. Yeah.
So
I love that Whalers song, by the way. I was a big Whalers fan, and I love that Whalers song. We have to put that on our website.
You guys didn't know each other like back then, but when I met you, Josh, I was like, oh my God, you like the Whalers? Like, I couldn't believe it. There was another one of you. And somehow I was friends with both of you.
We got to put the link to Brass Bonanza on our website.
Yes, I will do it.
You. So I in my last few years in Montreal, I actually rooted for the Whalers. And then during my travels between Montreal and Philadelphia, I rooted for whatever the home team was. So I'm not one of these people And there's a lot of people out there who sort of, they root for their team that they grew up with. And even after they move, they still root for that team. I'm the opposite. I will try to assimilate, I guess, as best as I can.
Mm-hmm.
So I spent time in Ottawa, for example, and I rooted for the Bills. And here now I root for the Eagles. It's just one of those things where I feel that it's important to become part of this.
Yeah, you were on the West Coast. I know you were like a Canucks guy for a little while.
Yep.
Yeah. Well, Pavel Bure was easy to fall in love with, I guess, back then too.
The Pavelis one.
Yeah. So tell us, like, what do you think the Flyers' chances are this year? Like, I know you probably came into the season with a lot of hope. You know, they finished strong last year, and they're just underwhelming again, right?
Underwhelming?
Yeah. No. Huh. Don't you find?
They're playing the Oilers right now, but they're going for their 7th win in a row.
I know, but still, I mean, they're not like, I mean, I guess they got hot, but I mean, okay, I guess so. 7th win in a row. But I mean, you're never as good as your winning streak. Like, that's 7 wins in a row. Like, can they sustain that? Or, like, where do you see them finishing? You see them finishing in the playoffs.
So I challenged a number of my friends to a bet.
Okay.
Which was, who will have more wins? Will it be the Eagles in the regular season?
Oh, well, God.
Or will it be the Flyers in the postseason?
Oh, God. That's a great bet.
So think
because
about that
the
a
Eagles
moment.
Probably will get no more than
8 wins.
8 is the high end. I think 8 is being like generous with them. Like maybe 7 or 6. But
so that would mean the Flyers would have to win the first round and get into the second round.
Well, yeah, they already have 5 wins, the Eagles. So that means you're thinking the Flyers are winning a playoff round.
Yes.
That's going to be tough.
So and right now they're in 7th place in the conference.
Yeah.
Yeah. So after last year, where they were the 8th seed, they snuck in right at the last minute.
Yeah, literally.
Yep. I figured this year they now brought up Konechny and Provorov.
Yeah.
Provorov,
I've never heard of those guys.
They are loaded with defenseman prospects, the Flyers, right?
Yeah, they are. So we have Konechny is he's about 5'10". He's small, but he's quick. He's fast. He has a tremendous skill. He's usually a center, but they have him on the wing.
Mm-hmm.
Provorov is going to be a 1 or 2 defenseman.
Right. And do you anticipate they're going to call up anyone else, or this is it?
For this year, probably that's it. But they have like Sam Morin, Hag. They have Travis Sanheim.
Yeah.
All waiting essentially for next year.
I know, Josh, like, I don't know. I followed it because like I speak to Mark often and I spend time in Philadelphia. They have so many prospects on the blue line that eventually they're going to make a trade. I don't think they can all be there. They're going to have to do something, right? Like, I don't think they can have all these guys up at once. It'll be kind of crazy.
Well, I mean, I guess they have some pieces to trade then at the trade deadline if they think they're going to make a run and they need a veteran.
I guess, yeah. Maybe they're going to pick a prospect that they're going to get rid of.
They might. They need scoring help, but that's almost like last year.
Yeah.
This year, they're number 2 in scoring.
That's great.
No one would have ever expected that. So just getting back to what you were saying before about they're having an underwhelming year. You're obviously looking at it through a Habs lens.
Yeah, I guess. Well, no, I actually hadn't realized they had rattled off all those 7 wins and where they put themselves right now in the standings, you know, so it's good for them. Yes. How is your guy Voracek doing?
He's doing great. So he actually worked out in the off season this year. you could tell he weighs less. Than he did, Eddie. He just looks faster.
Yeah.
Than he did last year. Last year he did. I think he had a couple of goals through the first 20 games or so. Hopefully you don't need to fact check that one, but you probably do.
He scares me when you.
Listeners actually, when we make mistakes, our listeners correct us, and then we make the corrections on the following episode.
No, but I know what you're saying though, Mark. He got off to a very slow start
a very very slow start. And this year we saw it in the preseason. You could just see he has an extra step on the ice and he can out-muscle anyone along the boards.
He's a scary player to play against. I know whenever we play the Habs play the Flyers, Voracek scares me because he's the whole package, you know?
Yeah. He's big, he's physical, and he's very gifted. skill wise, great playmaker, but also is a decent shot.
Right.
Yeah. And now you see his beard. I don't know. Have you seen him recently?
No.
He's a very bushy beard.
Oh, that's the new trend now, right? Yeah. That's like Brett Burns kind of started it, I guess. Yeah. And that's so ridiculous.
Check out the Skip and Josh Sports Show on Twitter. You know that little app with the little blue Tweety Bird? Yeah, you can follow them there at Skip and Josh.
I was going to ask, you said you have Flyer season tickets. I know that this weekend there's a big football matchup in Philadelphia, the Redskins at the Eagles. And I know the Eagles are pretty much done, but it's still a big game anytime the Redskins are in town. So A, are you going? And B, what is the outlook for the Eagles?
The Eagles. I wish you could have asked me that when they were 3-0.
Yeah.
Now the big talk in the city is whether the team is quitting. I don't know. You may have seen some highlights or lowlights of Zach Ertz deciding not to bother blocking when Carson Wentz started scrambling. And there's a couple of other examples of that. The coach has actually already mentioned the players aren't putting in as much effort as they probably should be.
Do you like Doug Peterson? Do you like him as the coach?
I don't mind him.
Me too.
Because, right. I think he's going to be okay. He's made some very questionable calls. Even, for example, the challenge for the where he challenged the call on the what was it? It was a 2-yard play.
Yeah, it was a two-yard play. It wasn't going to change anything. And then, great, he won the challenge. Everyone's like, oh, he won the challenge. But now he doesn't have this challenge when he really needs it.
That's right.
It made no sense. It made no sense. It was going to be 2nd and 10, or it was going to be 2nd and 8.
The other thing would. Where people will say, you know, it's a problem if you do it, whichever way you do it. So fans always want the team to go for it on 4th down.
Yeah.
Right? The funniest thing now is that most of the city is saying that we lost 2 games because we went for it on 4th down and we should have kicked field goals.
That's typical fans. Yeah, because there's one game where they went for it 3 times and then they didn't get it and they would have had those field goals, they would have won. Yeah. Right?
Yeah.
And like you said, the fans always want them to go. You know, right? They always want them to go for it. He's in a bad situation. They don't have a good team. That's the gist of it, right?
Yeah.
They got everyone excited because they were 3-0, but they don't have a good team.
Yeah, well, you're missing an offensive lineman because he's tested positive.
Yeah, Lane Johnson.
Or PEDs.
Yeah.
You've lost a wide receiver.
Well, they didn't have good receivers to start.
Then you lose them for carrying drugs, firearms.
Oh, that's Josh Huff you're talking about. Correct. Yeah, okay. Yeah.
All he did was come from New Jersey to Pennsylvania. That's all he did. And there's different gun laws in different states.
Wow. But then they cut him. The Eagles cut him.
Yes. Yeah, you have to have zero tolerance.
And then Aguilar, they sat him out because he can't do anything.
Well, that's a Steve Sachs type of a case, right? So if you remember Steve Sachs with his...
Couldn't throw to first.
No. There you go.
Yeah, but the problem is, Josh, this guy's a wide receiver and he can't catch.
That's a problem.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, yeah, like they really don't have any talented players at the skill positions. Like, they don't have good receivers. Their running backs are average at best, and they have a rookie quarterback. So it's a bad mix, you know?
It's a horrible mix.
Do you think... Like Chip Kelly came in and changed the entire roster, and I'm guessing that people in Philly are still angry at that. Had they still had some of those guys that Kelly got rid of, would the team be better, worse, the same?
It's a great question, but it's an easy one. If you had Macklin, DeSean Jackson, LeSean McCoy with Carson Wentz.
Oh, God, it would be amazing. Jeremy Macklin is a really good wide receiver. He's on Kansas City, like the most conservative offense in the whole league. That a team that doesn't even throw to their wide receivers, and he puts up good numbers. LeSean McCoy is a monster. Like, they got rid of him for no reason. There's talk that DeSean Jackson is going to re-sign with the Eagles this offseason when he's a free agent.
That wouldn't surprise me.
That means my son's DeSean Jackson jersey will come back out of the closet and it'll be like valid again.
Will he have the same jersey number though?
Well, he better.
He probably will.
The Eagles will probably make him pick another number so they could sell new jerseys.
Maybe.
It's such a cash cow. Yeah.
The answer to all your questions is money.
Yeah, that's true. You did go to one Eagles game this year. I know you sent me a picture.
I saw the game against the Falcons.
Is that the only game you went to this year?
Yeah, it's ridiculously expensive to go to a game here. And tickets are near impossible to get because you have to have season ticket memberships, right? So you have to buy the membership first, then you have to pay for the seats. So if you need to get tickets and you're looking at StubHub, you're looking for standing room only,
right,
which is in the corner of Lincoln Financial. You're looking at 100 plus just for standing room. And you may only have one ticket or two tickets. To get seats somewhere, you're looking at about 150, 170. For, and that's after the Eagles have already, I don't know, decided they don't feel like finishing the season.
Yeah, I guess, yeah. It's a really good bet that Flyers playoff wins versus Eagles season wins. That's one that we're going to definitely keep track of.
Yeah, it didn't look so good when the Eagles won their first three.
No.
I was very worried.
Yeah, because if they get 10 wins, I mean, the chances of the Flyers getting 10 playoff wins means they're going to the third round. That's serious, right? I mean,
yeah.
But honestly, I don't know if the Eagles will win another game. They'll probably end up 5-11.
They might win against Dallas if Dallas rests all their starters because that's the last week.
Oh, that's the last game.
The Skip and Josh Sports Show. They don't take your calls.
My son wanted me to ask you about, he heard that you were coming on our show today. He's like, oh, ask Mark about the Sixers. Matthew's really high on the Sixers. Do you follow the Sixers at all? I know we went to a game last year when I was there, but that was like more of a joke, kind of.
Yeah, so I think there were about 5,000 fans there.
Yeah.
Right? And at that point, we didn't have Simmons. We didn't have Embiid. So there wasn't much to follow.
Yeah. Do you find that like the Sixers are getting a little bit of buzz around them in the city? Or
as soon as the lottery number was picked.
Yeah.
As soon as they knew that we were getting the number one pick.
Yeah, but you've had the number one pick already so many times, no?
But this was different because there was a possibility of Ben Simmons.
Yeah, okay.
Then the people on sports talk radio, for example, they were watching summer league games. I mean, these aren't...
Yeah.
So they're what, you know, it's exhibitions just to see what this guy could actually do. And it's amazing. If you just watch his abilities on the court.
He's not a great shooter, though, but that doesn't mean anything because he's good at everything else, right?
That's right. In fact, they couldn't figure out where to play him, actually.
Yeah. I mean, my son's convinced that he's going to be a point guard when he comes back.
And your son is 100% right. The coach has already come out and said it.
Yeah, like so when he's kind back of in January. Point mm-hmm. forward type of situation. Yeah.
Yeah.
Is he coming back that early? He's coming back this year?
January.
Oh, that's going to be huge. They actually have like a...
They have a good nucleus.
Well, look, last year when we went, I wouldn't even consider them an NBA team. Like, they didn't even... The team they were fielding was so pathetic, it was like... It wasn't even NBA caliber. But this year with Embiid and Gerald Henderson, like, they've made some improvements that they're... I would consider them an NBA team at this point. So, yeah.
And they have probably too many big guys, but that was the problem they had by picking the best athlete when they did.
Right.
Right? With Noel and Okafor.
Yeah, and Embiid.
And Embiid. So yeah. It's a problem that they'll have to figure out, and everyone knows they have too many guys.
Embiid's the front runner right now for Rookie of the Year, and it's already like his third year.
He's incredible,
that's the funniest
though.
Thing.
He is... They owed it to him to play him and see what they had, right? Obviously, they made him, like, they picked him. They wanted to pick him, and he had all this hype around him. I remember when he was drafted, people were comparing him to Hakeem Olajuwon. Like, let's see what he's got. And so far, he's as advertised. You know, obviously, he's no Hakeem Olajuwon, but, I mean, he's good. There's no question he's good.
Yeah, what's interesting is that he actually grew a couple of inches over the last year.
That's what they were saying when he got drafted. Yeah, so he's well over 7 feet now.
I think he's 7'2".
And he hits threes. I see in the box scores, he hits threes. It's crazy.
Hi there. Skip and Josh will be right back. To get in touch with them, you can send them an email to skipandjoshshow@gmail.com. You can follow them on Twitter @skipandjosh, and you can visit their website at www.skipandjosh.com. And now, back to the show.
Think, and correct me if I'm wrong, that your favorite sport is baseball. Is that true?
Another good question, I think, Josh. Baseball is my true love. It's one of those things that when you walk into a baseball stadium, it's like a holy ground.
Right? I agree 100%.
Yeah.
Love the game. There's something about it. You can go to anything else. I also follow MLS soccer. And which I never did before, but all of a sudden my kid plays, so all of a sudden he's interested, so I should be interested, I guess. But it's not a pitch. A soccer pitch isn't the same. And the even though the stadium they built in Philadelphia is actually is very nice, it's right on a river. But I do love baseball. But right now, to be honest, I think I'm a much bigger Flyers fan than I am a Phillies fan. It could be because I've seen the rise of the Phillies in 2006 through 2011 or so, and I've also seen their fall.
This leads to my next question about the Phillies. I'm on their website looking at their 25-man roster, and I can only recognize three names. Howie Kendrick, I've heard of, and Pat Neshek, I've heard of.
They just got him yesterday.
And Joaquin Benoit, I've heard of.
They just got him yesterday.
They got him yesterday, too.
Only three guys I've heard of. I can't tell you. I'm reading these names. I've never heard of any of them. And the Phillies, it seems like not that long ago when they had Cliff Lee and Roy Halladay, and they had Ryan Howard and Jimmy Rollins and all these other guys. And they, like you said, they won the World Series. And then it seemed like they just sort of gave up.
They hung on to their guys. They won the World Series and they went to the World Series, right? And then they held on to their veterans too long, and they didn't supplement them with any young talent, right? So they kept thinking that Ryan Howard and Jimmy Rollins were going to get them to the promised land, even though they, couldn't hit anymore.
Ryan Howard was probably the most disappointing. After he tore his Achilles at the end of the second World Series. He's just never been the same.
We went to a game last year, Josh, me and Mark and our families in Philadelphia against the Mets, and Ryan Howard actually played in the game. So he gets up there, he's hitting like 190. They show his stats. He's hitting 190, and he gets up there and he hits a home run. And of course the kids were freaking out, cuz to see a home run, the little, it was great, and it's just so funny.
But before we're all like gloom and doom for the Phillies, their pitching staff, they've started building something here. They have a lot of young guys who are high draft picks that they've gotten from other organizations, as part of whether it be dumping, older players or other trades, and so they've come up in the farm system altogether, essentially. So we have a bunch, probably three, maybe four guys, Jared Eichhoff, one Zach Eflin, Aaron Nola, and these guys are, I'm probably even missing a couple, but it's amazing what these guys are capable of. A lot of them just played their first full season last year, and it's amazing. Some of them are amazing to watch, whether it's more of some of them are more power pitchers, and then you have folks like Aaron Nola who are finesse, but good speed as well, and he has an incredible changeup. So you get some strikeouts, but his control is incredible.
Don't you have a big prospect also, a shortstop? I forget his name.
J.P. Crawford.
Yeah, is he going to play this year?
He was supposed to play last year. I had him on my fantasy team.
Oh God.
Yeah, he didn't play at all. Didn't start out the season very well in the minor. It was he got called up from AA to AAA. Didn't play well at all there. Then he got hurt. The question is whether I need to keep him in my fantasy pool or not.
Yeah. Well.
So how many Phillies games do you go to a year, or any at all?
I try. Well, because I love the game, because I want to instill a love of the game to my kids. I try to go to at least one or two games a year. It's also important that they learn how to score a game,
which they didn't want to try.
But
it's hard to teach that to like a 5-year-old. No. But once they're maybe 10, I don't know.
My son didn't want, and his kids didn't want, and my daughter ended up trying, but it's like beyond her.
See, my oldest, I took him to his first game. He was probably 6. He sat through the entire game. He actually scored. He learned the positions and what the numbers were. Now that he's 11... a different story.
Right.
Well, it is a slow game. I love baseball, but it is a slow game, and I can understand how little kids could find it boring, especially when the games are starting so late, especially in the playoffs, that you know, your kids are probably asleep before the game even starts, assuming the Phillies make the playoffs, whatever. So I get that young kids prefer basketball or soccer or hockey or whatever it is.
Yeah, the my kids, well, one of them much prefers going to a soccer game or watching soccer on TV than anything baseball, which is quite sad for a dad who, you know, all they want to do is have a catch with their kid.
Yeah, I know.
I know in Philadelphia, all the stadiums are right near each other. You and I went to a game together actually many years ago. How far is it from where you live to get to the ballpark or to get to the hockey rink?
Depends on the traffic. But the short answer is about 25, 30 minutes to the Wells Fargo Citizens Bank Park, Lincoln Financial Field area, and about 40 to Talon Energy Park, which is where the Philadelphia Union play.
That's not so bad, actually.
Skip, do you want to talk about the trying to get out of a parking lot after the Eagles game?
Oh, my God. So, Josh, so we went to the Eagles game. It was a Sunday night game. We parked. First of all, we paid $40 for parking.
Crazy.
And we parked in the parking lot, which is next to the stadium, like everybody else.
You don't have a choice. It's not like you can park on the street there.
Exactly. You know, I mean, I guess you could, but no, you have no choice. So we park, and then we come out of the game. We stayed for the whole game. And what happens? We get in the car. Mark's driving. He literally turns the wheel to 45-degree angle and advances the car 6 inches. And we stayed in that position for 45 minutes.
That's awful.
Okay? Yeah. We didn't move. I don't know why, like, we literally didn't move. 45 minutes. After 45 minutes, we started to see where we could go, and we got into a little bit of a crawl. And then it took about 20 more minutes, like, from the first 45. Once we started moving, it took about 20 minutes to get out of the parking lot and onto the highway and then home. Now, contrast that with the Sixers game two nights later, where we literally park in the same parking lot. Actually, we park closer. We park, like, literally next to the arena.
Yeah, you were.
We paid $20.
Half as much.
And we got out of the parking lot in 3 minutes when the game was over.
So let me ask you this. At the end of the, you said it was a football game?
Yeah, it was the Eagles.
That took you 45 minutes to get out of?
Yeah.
Rather than sit in the car for 45 minutes, is there somewhere to go to have dinner or something or lunch and then leave? Well,
you could. Like, if it was me and Mark alone, we would have done something different. But he had his son, I had mine. Mark's son is a little bit younger. It was already a stretch for him to stay up that late, to be honest. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we wanted to get home. So, yeah.
I get it.
Yeah.
Great thing about the Philadelphia Sports Complex is they've created Xfinity Live right where the old Spectrum used to be.
This is what you're talking about, Josh. It's like a place to hang out.
So it is a huge area of multiple pubs, bars, televisions everywhere. And they can accommodate, because it's, I wouldn't say it's the size of the Spectrum, but it's, imagine a just group of pubs that are arena sized. In fact, I'll be there with my younger one before the Flyers game on Saturday against the Stars.
Fun.
But that would have been a good idea. But that game, by the way, should have been in the afternoon. But thanks to the NFL and television, they decided to use their flex option.
Right.
Afternoon to evening.
Right.
That starts with what, like 4 or 6 weeks left in the season?
It's starting now, yeah. I think it started this week or last week.
Okay.
But sometimes they don't change anything. They just leave it as is, right? You don't know. They tell you when they've changed it.
Well, this Sunday is Cowboys-Giants. I don't know if that's what it was originally, but that's what it is now.
Yeah, well, they're not changing that for sure.
No, they're not.
Before we change the subject away from the Philadelphia arenas, I want to mention that the best ballpark food I ever had at any baseball stadium was at the Citizens Bank Park last time we went. It was this fried chicken sandwich from Federal Donut, and it comes with these little donuts on the side. Mark, do you remember? You didn't have it, but me and Matthew had it.
I remember. So I know about Federal Donuts. I know that it's tasty. But having said that, you've obviously a short-term memory.
Why?
The best food was at the Olympic Stadium.
Oh, are you crazy?
Kojak's.
Kojak's, exactly.
Are you crazy?
And there was also smoked meat as well.
They had smoked meat, yeah, Kojak's. We used to have, Josh, you didn't know us back then, but we used to always say, like, we had to
spend more than the cost of the
ticket. Yeah.
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 Which back then, when the ticket tickets were $8 at one point, or $6 even.
Yeah, but hot dogs were $1, $2, you know. Yeah, well,
don't they have, Mark, at the is it Citizen Bank? Don't they have a sandwich or a sub or something named after Mike Schmidt, and another thing named after Steve Carlton?
No, well, Greg Luzinski has his restaurant, the Bull something, right?
Yeah, and they have the Schmitter, which is
all the parks have that. Josh, remember when we were in Chicago at the White Sox park? They had like Black Jack McDowell and the Big Hurt Burger, and
that's right. You know,
so one question you brought up pricing of hot dogs.
Yeah.
At the hockey game, I guess it was on Tuesday, it was a dollar dog night.
Oh, great.
So here's a trivia question, Josh. Okay. How many hot dogs do you think they sold on dollar dog night?
At the Flyers game?
At the Flyers game, like versus the Panthers.
I mean, if there were 18,000 people at the game, I'm going to assume they sold 18,000 hot dogs.
So they didn't, because of the nature of the end of the third period and overtime, and they didn't actually flash up the final totals, but midway through the third they were up to about 11,500.
It's pretty crazy, because Josh, you're assuming everybody's going to get a hot dog. Some people don't want, right,
but, or some people are going to get two and somebody's not going to get any, right?
Yeah. I was going to say the same thing, 18,000.
Yeah.
How many did you have?
I had two. The person I was with had two, but we had already had dinner. We said it was the middle, it was the second intermission, and we said, you know, are you hungry? No, but it's dollar dog night.
You got it. Oh, you okay. Have to just out of spite, just out of principle.
By the way, if we're going to talk about hot dogs, you have to remember at the old Montreal Forum, the toasted hot dogs, those were the best.
They still have them at the Bell Center, but the price is ridiculous, and
you can't buy anything at the Bell Center.
They're just okay. Yeah.
A beer and a hot dog, you have to take out another mortgage.
A beer? You know how much a beer is at the Bell Center?
I don't know.
It's like almost $20.
No.
Every hockey rink, I think
it's
like
I think it's
like
18 something.
You can get a, what is it? It's like a pint and a half, maybe, of Labatt, which is funny that they sell
Labatt. That's like, what they sell at the Flyer games, Labatt.
They sell, you can get it on tap even.
It's like some kind of exotic Canadian beer.
Yeah. A Canadian beer has more alcohol in it,
I don't think
right?
they even make Labatt's beer here anymore. No, they do. They must. Labatt Blue. Must. It has to exist. Yeah.
But yeah, so it's about $10.
Yeah, okay. Well, that makes sense.
The Skip and Josh Sports Show is back.
We've covered like all the major sports, but I know Josh really wanted to pick your brain about how you're undefeated in our fantasy football league.
Yeah, your team is ridiculous. First of all, you're undefeated, and last week it looked like you were finally going to lose. Your starting QB was on a bye, and you were down early in the day on Sunday. You were down by like 80 points or something, but most of your players hadn't played. And then Sunday night you had two Seattle Seahawks players, and they totaled almost 30 points, and you ended up winning, I think, 125 to 121 or something crazy like that. But Skip mentioned it on an earlier show. We looked at your roster, and you don't have any good players. We don't understand how you're undefeated.
You use different guys each week also, right? It's like every week there's like another guy getting 25 points.
I'm starting, I think it's my fourth quarterback for the season.
Yeah.
This week. I've had Manning, Mariota, Rivers, and Tyrod Taylor.
Tyrod.
And Jameis Winston. So I guess it's five. And they've all started at least one game for me.
Wow.
And I can't say that's the secret. I think the strategy was that from the very, I guess at draft time, was you need running backs and wide receivers and the quarterbacks. Maybe they're not maybe streaming like a kicker or defense special teams, but they're a little bit more, you can be a little more flexible with them.
Yeah, there are a lot of quarterbacks. Like you said, like Mariota, Winston, these guys go unnoticed, right? And if your quarterback's hurt, there's always someone you could pick up, especially in our league. It's like, well, there's always guys.
It's interesting that you have Jameis Winston and Marcus Mariota, because I think they were drafted 1-2 in the same year, if I'm not mistaken.
That's right. You're spot on.
And you've got them both. And they're both on your bench.
This week.
So who are you using this week?
Phil Rivers.
Rivers?
Yeah.
Wow. You just picked him up this afternoon. I noticed that.
I did.
Well, you're starting. You just. I think you found your formula. You have to use a different guy every week. So you're just picking up someone just so you can pick someone up.
Well, no, I do have an excellent core, right? I have David Johnson, DeMarco Murray.
Well, I mean, David Johnson. I was talking with Matthew yesterday, and we were talking about next year's fantasy football, mm-hmm. and I said, I'm pretty sure David Johnson is the number one ranked fantasy player next year going into the mm-hmm. season. And he said, what about Ezekiel Elliott? I said, yeah, that's a good one, but I don't know. David Johnson is just a beast.
He is.
Yeah. Passing. And it's funny because the game, his coming out party was the game that we went to against the Eagles last year.
Unfortunately.
That was the game where he just dominated and he never slowed down after that.
I know when at that game, midway through the game, we even said, I don't understand why no one is tackling.
Yeah, now we had, but now the rest of the league is saying that, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, they couldn't tackle him.
Crazy but stuff. And I also have Melvin Gordon, too. So we have three running backs who have always played. They haven't gotten hurt.
And Melvin Gordon sucks, but he scores touchdowns.
Yeah.
Right? He doesn't get a lot of yards, but every game they give him the ball on the goal line.
Well, San Diego's had a lot of injuries, so Melvin Gordon, I don't know where he was on the depth chart before the season started, but he's their top guy now, right?
They had, like, running back by committee, but he's getting all the goal line carries. And it's like, whenever a guy gets, like, a disproportionate amount of touchdowns, it's always weird, you know? And he's doing it, you know, so what are you going to do?
And then last week's star, so Thomas Rawls.
Yeah.
He's on my bench this week.
Yeah, well, as he should be. Like, me and Josh talked about it on the previous episode, which, you know, we just recorded, but Thomas mm-hmm. Rawls had 20 something points last week and he has like two other total points the whole season.
Yeah.
I know all about Thomas Rawls cause I drafted him and he frustrated me. So
but whenever Josh cuts a guy, that's who you have to pick up.
That's exactly
what we found out. Cause Book has a whole bunch and you've got
Crabtree.
I got Crabtree. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So Josh, let me ask one question. So let's say your team is 1 week away from being undefeated. Would you rather finish this regular season undefeated, but let's say lose in the first round of the playoffs? Or would you would say you wouldn't mind losing the last week of the playoffs or last week of the regular season, but going all the way?
No, you have to win the championship.
I'd rather win the championship, even if it meant losing the last regular season game.
Because no one's going to remember.
But you don't have to worry about resting your guys or anything like that, because you're not a real coach.
I think if I was in Mark's position, I would rest my guys. I just rest them. You know,
that reminds me of...
Treat it like a regular team, you know? Rest your guys.
That reminds me of...
I know what you're going to say. I know what you're going to say.
Stratomatic?
100%. I knew it.
I never played Stratomatic, but I heard about this guy who, when he played Stratomatic, he would roll, I don't know what it was, before they started playing, and if he got a certain roll, his game was rained out and he wouldn't play.
Is that amazing?
Who is that?
We don't want to say. I know who it is. I don't think Josh wants to call a person out.
No, I don't even. Wow. I think it was a friend of my brother's. I don't even know who
it
was.
I thought it was your brother.
No, I think it was a friend of his.
Okay.
That's ingenious.
Oh, my God. It's amazing. Rained out. Sorry, you're not playing. Yeah, so you should rest them. You should rest your guys. Well, you are. You're using a new quarterback, so. If David Johnson gets injured this week, it's going to be your fault.
I hope not. So I also have the one big injury I did have this year was AJ Green.
Yeah, that's true. But, you know, you have Johnson and DeMarco, so those are like that can carry you, right?
If I have a non-sports question for you, Mark.
Great.
And it's like a two-parter.
Okay.
So the first part is, do you watch the show The Goldbergs?
I don't, but I do know about it.
The reason I ask is because it's set in Philadelphia.
Yeah.
And so you won't know the answer to my next question then because you don't watch the show. They've got obviously the main characters, you know, it's the mom, the dad, and the three kids and whatever. And it's based on the kids' real life, sort of, because sometimes they show clips, you know, when he used to shoot stuff with his video camera when he was a kid. So a lot of the stories in the show are based on his real life. But there's a student in the school, And the teacher keeps calling out to the student. He's not a regular character on the show. He only appears sometimes. And they call the student by his full name, and it's Ruben Amaro Jr.
Yep. Really?
So every Yes. So every time I hear this, I'm like, Ruben Amaro Jr. was the GM of the Phillies, if I'm not mistaken, and now he's like a third base coach something or something, right?
Yep.
But he was a player too.
He was a player. He was a bat boy. He was a bat boy before he was a player.
So did Ruben Amaro Jr. go to school in Philadelphia? Why do they keep using that guy's name in the show, or do you not even know?
I don't know, but it's a Philadelphia show, and I'm sure they've tried to put in as many linkages as possible.
That's amazing. I can't believe you watched. You know what's amazing? First of all, that you asked this question is great, but I can't believe you watched that show.
It's a great show.
Really?
It's a great show.
I'm looking it up right now. He was born and raised in Northeast Philadelphia.
It's a great show. I highly recommend everyone watch it.
Okay. I'll try to watch one episode and I'll tell you if it's good.
I think you'll like it.
He was a bat boy from the Phillies from 1980 to 83. Yeah, he's the only guy in history that went from being a GM to a third base coach.
Base coach. But that's impressive.
Maybe it's even first base coach. I don't even know.
First base coach. It's amazing.
Is like the least possible amount of responsibility you could have.
First base coach. You don't have to do anything.
Exactly.
He now has to be in a uniform.
You know what the first base coach does? He takes the guy's like shin guard or elbow guard when they get on base, and
exactly.
He hands it to the bat boy.
That's what he does.
Yeah.
Biggest. I could do that.
Yeah, of course. Well, thank you for coming on, Mark. We'll definitely have you on again as the NHL season heats up and the Flyers hopefully progress as far as you want them to go. And we'll probably have you on again to recap the death of the Eagles season when it finally ends.
Well, that's coming up pretty soon.
Yeah, it's coming up pretty soon, yeah. Yeah.
Thanks very much, Mark. It was great having you on the show.
Well, thanks. It's been great chatting with both of you. So thanks again.
The Skip and Josh Sports Show is over now. Don't worry, there'll be another episode soon.